You sprint through the crumbling streets of Seattle, the ground violently shaking beneath you. It feels like the world is falling apart as the earth turns to liquid under your feet. Panic takes over as fires rage. Buildings collapse around you. Your only thought is to get to the mountains, to get to safety. Then suddenly everything goes quiet. The shaking stops. You turn around and your heart drops. A massive wall of water over 100 feet high looms over the city, ready to obliterate everything in its path. This isn't a disaster movie, it's real life, and that wave, it's coming for you. Welcome to today's episode of the Infographic Show. We'll show you what a Richter 10 earthquake really looks like. If you've ever been in California, you've probably heard conversations about the big one, that one huge earthquake that's gonna wipe us all out, thanks to the San Andreas Fault. Well, there may be a big one on the horizon, but it probably won't be that far south. That's right, San Andreas and Dwayne "The Rock" Johnson lied to us. While everyone warily looks at Southern California, the real problem is brewing up north in the beautiful forests of the Pacific Northwest, the Cascadia Subduction Zone. And if that earthquake hits, it will be more terrifying than you can imagine. The Cascadia Subduction Zone runs 700 miles from Northern California to British Columbia, around 70 to 100 miles inland from the Pacific Ocean. Places like Seattle would be right in the middle of it all, a sort of ground zero for an earthquake in the area. And how would you know it's coming? Imagine you're standing near the Space Needle. Suddenly there's a change in the air. Every dog around you starts barking nonstop at something. What's happening? The first sign of the earthquake has arrived, the compression wave, also known as the P wave. Moving fast at very high frequencies, humans can't hear or sense it, but dogs and other animals can, and they understand that something is very wrong. The compression wave is released before the actual rumbling of the earthquake starts. Though this might not seem like a lot of time, it's enough for people to take cover, mass transit to shut down and evacuate, and people to get out of elevators. In Japan, compression waves set off early alarm systems that warn people to do all of that. Unfortunately, in the Pacific Northwest, besides Fido barking in your ear, there will be no such early warning alarm because it hasn't been built. That's because the Cascadia Subduction Zone wasn't fully understood until after a lot of the area was settled. It also has a unique combination of experiencing very damaging but very rare earthquakes, which have made the need for earthquake detection systems seem less pressing. Suddenly, the sound of dogs barking is drowned out by the sound of rumbling and cracking in the ground. The second, deadlier wave, known as an S wave or a shear wave, has arrived, and it is impossible to escape. The shear wave is the result of stress built up between the two tectonic plates of the North American continent. They meet at the subduction zone. The western plate, known as the Juan de Fuca, a much too sassy name for a thing that causes deadly earthquakes, pushing under the eastern plate, known as the North American plate. Unfortunately for Juan, the North American plate is stuck in its place as it's jammed up against another plate. So instead of peacefully shifting around each other, Juan de Fuca ends up violently grating under the North American plate, making the latter rise. Once in a while, the slow grind builds up stress until it becomes more of a heavy slip, wreaking havoc on the ground above. This gets the zone as close to a Richter 10 earthquake as scientists currently think is possible. In the absence of something crazy like an asteroid hitting the Earth, which would theoretically cause a much larger earthquake. Scientists doubt there are fault lines on Earth that are big enough to release an earthquake that would reach a 10 on the Richter scale, but then again, scientists also didn't understand the depth and danger of the Cascadia Zone until fairly recently. A 10 on the Richter scale is 10 times as devastating as a 9, because the scale is exponential. In the past, earthquakes in the 9 to 10 area, like in Chile 9.5 and Japan 9.1, have caused tens of thousands of deaths and wiped entire cities off the map. But the Cascadia Zone worries scientists because they think an event here could be even deadlier. Back to Seattle, where buildings are starting to crack and break all around you. The only thing you know about earthquakes is that you should take cover, but the chunks of concrete falling all around you make this difficult. The ground itself is moving like a wave, shaking you off your feet and making even standing still difficult. You start to run toward the hills to the east, hoping you can get to higher ground and avoid the collapsing debris around you. But first, here's something important to remember about therapy. You don't have to have a clinical mental health issue like depression or anxiety to benefit from it. Therapy is a safe space where you can share what's on your mind, whether it's stress, sadness, worries, or relationship issues, without fear of judgment. A therapist asks thoughtful questions and helps you view things from new angles. They can give you useful insights and practical techniques to manage your emotions, reduce stress, and make positive shifts in your life. Seeking therapy is actually a sign of strength and self-awareness. It takes courage to acknowledge when you need help and to take steps to improve your mental health. While therapy can sometimes be expensive, there are affordable options available, like online therapy platforms. BetterHelp is the sponsor of this video, and they're on a mission to make starting therapy easier. BetterHelp is a platform where therapists and their clients can communicate effectively and get the most out of therapy. Starting therapy is easy with BetterHelp. Fill out a questionnaire and you'll match with a therapist in as little as a couple of days. They carefully make sure therapists on the platform are well qualified, and their customer support team is there to help you if you have any questions. If you're struggling and think you'd benefit from a therapy session, click the link in the description or go to betterhelp.com/infographics and get 10% off your first month of therapy. You look down to see what the problem is, and you notice the ground is liquefying before your very eyes. A good portion of the Northwest is built on sand and silt. Some scientists say a Richter 10 could reach up to 30 uninterrupted minutes of shaking, which would eventually cause the soil itself to act like a liquid. As you try to remember from cartoons how to escape quicksand beneath your feet, you see entire skyscrapers sliding into the ground, literally sinking. With a lot of effort, you get closer to the hill you've spotted, but you stop in your tracks because a massive landslide is careening down the hill right toward you. In fact, landslides are happening everywhere. The streets are filling up with mud and dirt dislodged from nearby hills and making places impassable. You need to find cover and quick. The hospital right next to you, which you thought may be built more sturdily than anything else around it, has cracked open. Almost no building in the world is made to withstand a Richter 10 earthquake, a literal civilization-ending natural disaster. Electrical wires snap all around you, and dangerous chemicals spill out of every place that they're stored or used in, including hospital equipment. The combination of chemicals and sparks causes fires to erupt in every direction, almost as far as the eye can see. Since the ground is moving and sliding around, the fires on top of them are pretty mobile at the moment as well. A few minutes later, the endless rumbling and snapping from underneath your feet ceases. You look around as one last piece of drywall sailing through the air falls next to you, a small moment of silence. But you know something else is coming, something big and possibly unsurvivable. When the Cascadia subduction zone causes an earthquake, the ground that makes up the Juan de Fuca could fall up to 6 feet under the North American tectonic plate. These 6 feet, when spread out over a big chunk of the Pacific coast, add up to a lot of water displaced at once. You finally climb up the hill you've been trying to reach and look out over the Pacific. In the distance, you see something strange. A giant mass of water has risen up in the middle of the ocean. The seawater is actually much further out than usual, with hundreds of feet of underwater rocks and fish exposed on the sand. Then the mass of water starts to fall. Your hair stands on end as you realize what this means. The tsunami is coming. But it doesn't form a classic big wave. Instead, it looks more like the entire ocean has risen 100 feet up and is barreling toward the shore. And you have no more than 10 to 30 minutes to make it out. You're gonna need a bigger hill. You look up to the Cascade Mountains in the east. Your car is buried under layers of concrete somewhere, and even if you could steal another one, we're sure the cops will understand committing a crime just this once. How are you gonna get there? The entire road heading up to the mountains is cracked open. Huge chunks of it is missing. A bridge further ahead has been entirely wiped out, steel beams jutting out of the river below it. So what do? You run. You run for your life and you don't look back. That's because tsunamis are some of the least survivable natural disasters around. The best way to avoid dying in one is to be nowhere near the place where it hits, which isn't encouraging as you see a wall of water slamming through the western coast of Seattle on its way to you. You break into the fastest sprint you can manage, heading higher and higher to save your life. You turn around for a second and see that the tsunami has passed the first buildings of the city, and it's no longer just water. The fast-moving wave is pushing along trucks, utility poles, house walls, and a whole pile of massive debris, taking down everything in its path. No human is a match for this. Water only needs to move at just under 7 miles an hour to knock over an adult man. And that's when the water only reaches up to your ankles. But water is deceptive and dangerous. It doesn't need to be too fast or too deep to take you down. And this water isn't at your ankles. It's anywhere between 50 to 100 feet above sea level and moving at almost 15 miles per hour. That's the height of a 4 to 7 floor apartment building, moving at the speed of a bull in Pamplona. You turn back toward the mountain and sprint upwards, avoiding the destroyed bridge by using a land crossing you know. The scene is utter chaos and confusion, as sprinting toward the mountain alongside you are over 70,000 people fleeing the city. Some of you, either the most desperate and or athletic, reach the 100-foot mark of the mountain as the tsunami passes right below you. You find an open field away from any tall trees and ride out the many incredibly strong aftershocks of the mega disaster that just happened. As you pass the time waiting for help, you look down to see the city of Seattle completely destroyed, buildings submerged in the ground, water covering everything. The silver lining is that at least the tsunami put the fires out. A Richter 10 earthquake leaves almost no surviving buildings or infrastructure. You look toward the east and see that everything up to Interstate 5 looks like a nuclear bomb hit it, which isn't far from the truth. When the 1960 earthquake in Chile happened, at a 9.5 on the Richter scale, more than one person actually thought it was a nuclear attack due to the escalating Cold War. The reality is even worse. A Richter 10 earthquake unleashes the same energy as 1 million nuclear bombs, like the one used on Hiroshima. We'll remind you that the nuclear bomb dropped on that city instantly killed 78,000 people and leveled huge chunks of the metro area, and let you imagine how bad 1 million of those would be. And the damage doesn't stop there. The tsunami didn't just hit here. A second wave made it all the way to Japan and another to Chile, flooding major cities and annihilating everything in their path. With a Richter 10 earthquake, almost no part of the planet is safe. Infrastructure, cities, civilization as we know it would be so damaged that rebuilding within a human lifespan would be almost impossible. Even if the government and emergency services could send help, it would take weeks to make their way through the mountain passes completely blocked by landslides, over bridges wiped off the map by the tsunami, using roads that are sticking up in jagged shards from the earth below. You're probably wondering, how likely is the earthquake we just described? Well, over the last 10,000 years, there have been exactly 41 earthquakes caused by stress built up in the subduction zone in the Pacific Northwest. That means about one earthquake every 243 years. The last such earthquake was in 1700. For those of you good at math, you might be starting to panic, since there should have been another earthquake around 1943, and we're more than 80 years past that. As for the good news, most scientists think that a subduction earthquake in this area would probably not pass a 9.2 on the Richter scale. The 9.5 scale earthquake in Chile happened on a fault line over 1,000 miles long, while the Cascadia fault line is around 700 miles. So at least an earthquake here won't be a world-ending catastrophe, just a regional one. So what should you do if you live in the Pacific Northwest? Reinforce your home, learn earthquake safety, and hope for the best. Oh, and get a dog. You'll know the earthquake is coming before anyone else. Now go check out the worst natural disasters in human history or this video instead.